I'd also like to ask you about some of the other work you're doing now with the Mary Robinson Foundation. Usually climate change is seen as an environmental issue, and I find it fascinating that you're coming at it from a perspective of climate justice and human rights, which I think is a link that is too rarely made in this situation. And I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about the intersections you see between climate change and the women, peace, and security agenda.
I came to the issue of climate change not as an environmentalist or a scientist or specialist. I just saw it on the ground in the African countries I was working in when I was heading up Realizing Rights, because we were looking at right to food and safe water, health and education, and I described what I called the "ah but" sentence. I kept hearing people at all levels, but particularly at grassroots level in villages, etc., saying, "Ah, but things are so much worse." My friend Constance O'Kellett in northern Uganda would say to me, "Mary, when I was growing up, we were poor, but we had food because we had predictable seasons, and you know, things were okay. But for the last 10 years, that would have been, you know, in about 2008, she was saying that, for the last 10 years, we have had a complete change in our weather pattern. We now have long periods of drought, and then we get flash flooding. It's destroyed the school." And she actually formed a women's group to cope with that. And I hear this all over the world, weather conditions in vulnerable countries, because they're hit first. And where's the justice in that? These are not people who drive cars, who use oil or gas or coal. They're not responsible for greenhouse gas emissions, and yet they're the worst affected. And that brought me to a notion of climate justice which links climate and development, and which also has ideas about solutions. We have a world that's so unequal that 2.6 billion out of the 7 billion in the world cook on open fires, ingest fumes that hurt, cut down trees to do that. And we need to have them have access to clean cook stoves, which again is an issue I know that both Ambassador Milan Bevere and former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton have pushed. I'm on the lead group also of the Alliance for Clean Cook Stoves. 1.3 billion don't have access to electricity. They spend far too much money on dangerous kerosene and candles. And these are targets for a climate justice. We also, over the next years until the end of 2015, want to link more the post-2015 development agenda and the necessity for a fair, equitable climate agreement. And you can tell I'm as passionate about that as I am about the Great Lakes. I try to think to myself, it's 50-50, and a wise friend said, "No, Mary, it's 75-75, whatever, I'll try."
Since you are one of the greatest voices in the human rights discourse today, I would say, what would you identify as the human rights cause of our time? And out of curiosity, do you think it's the same today as it is when you first started in this field?
I don't think it's the same, and I think when I tell you what I think, a lot of human rights people will say, "Oh no, I don't agree with that." But I feel it very strongly. It's actually the fact that we have such an unjust system that is aggravated by climate change. Climate change is becoming one of the worst threats to human rights, because it's undermining food, it's undermining water, it's causing people to have to move from their homes in very dangerous situations. It's predicted that by 2050, that's 37 years' time, we could have 200 million climate-displaced people. We have no regime for them. They don't come under refugees. And so I think it's because it's aggravating all the situations in the fragile and vulnerable states that are already affected. It's the additional pressure that we're not taking seriously. And there's both the immediate climate justice and there's the intergenerational justice. You know, I have four grandchildren and they're aged 9 to 4, and they will be in their 40s in 2050. I fear greatly how they will share a world with 9 billion others. I care about that world, in a situation where we have more and more climate shocks and more ways of destabilizing and undermining human rights. So when I was growing up in the west of Ireland, when I was president of Ireland, when I was High Commissioner for Human Rights, I was not as focused on this. Now I am.